everyone. Thank you for attending my talk. My name is Richa. I have worked on Android since more than 3 years now, and I've spoken at my local communities in India. This is my first DroidCon talk, so a special thanks to DroidCon Berlin for hosting me. Today I'm going to talk about the newly introduced physics-based animation library in Android, which you can use to build some really cool effects, like the ones I'm going to show you in my presentation. So what is physics-based animation? So it was introduced in Google I/O 2017. Physics-based animation is an animation that is driven by force. Based on the force, acceleration or deacceleration can be calculated, which can then be used to calculate and update the velocities and values for the animation at each frame. That's why it mimics the law of physics. This physics-based animation comes to rest when the force reaches equilibrium. So before the physics-based animation, we had object animators, animator-based animation. So in animator-based animation, they are fairly static and has a fixed duration. Like you can see in this scenario where the target value needs to change during the animation, to accommodate the change in the target value, we need to cancel the animation at the time of target value change and reconfigure the animation with the current value as the new start value and add the target value. So because of this this process creates an abrupt process in the abrupt stop in the animation, and which doesn't look natural. So now what we have, so in the physics-based animation, so what you can see the difference, this animation, physics-based animation APIs are driven by force. Now change in the target value results in a change in the force. Now this change in the force applies on the existing velocity, which makes a continuous transition to the new target. This process results in a natural looking animation. So how physics-based animation is different? Because it is natural, it is reactive, and it has less visual disruption, which means that animation will look more natural and mimic real-time movements, and then you can have a smoother experience for the user. So now, in order to get started, you need to add this physics-based support library in your Gradle file, and this library provides two classes, Spring Animation and Fling Animation. Now I'm going to walk you through these two classes and how to create cool effects using these two. So first, let's start through Spring Animation. And so I'm going to ask, like, in real life, when an object is attached to a spring, and when you pull that object, the string stretches. And when you release the object, it returns to its initial position with a bouncy spring effect. So how can we simulate that in our app? So Spring Animation is here for you, which can easily do that for you. So for doing this, we need, I'm going to take you through two examples. First, like, how to do the translate using Spring Animation, and second, how to do the rotate and translate using Spring Animation. So first, do the translate. So now you can see we have an image view in the center, and when we move it up or down with my finger, it returns to its initial position with some spring effect, some bounciness. So to simulate that in our app, like, suppose your view has been animated to some different position, and then you want your view to return back to its initial position with a bouncy spring force that makes it oscillate before coming to rest at equilibrium. So what we need to do it here is, like, first we need to understand the different properties of string so that we can, I will show you how to code it. So spring force defines the properties of spring being used in animation. And what are the different properties? What you can control the damping ratio, stiffness, and resting position via spring animation. So first, let's go through the damping ratio. What is damping ratio? It controls the bounciness of a spring. So in bounciness, it does means, like, number of oscillations before coming to rest. So you can change the bounciness of a spring, like how many times it should oscillate before coming to rest, by simply setting the damping ratio. And a damping ratio of 0, remember that it would oscillate infinitely and will never come to rest. And a very high damping ratio will not have much animation oscillations and will stop very quickly. And so this API has given us four constants, from high medium, low, and no bouncy. So you can use this constant, or otherwise you can use any positive float value for the spring damping in your animation. Now let's go through stiffness. What is a stiffness? So stiffness means like how quick the oscillation is, how quick the object can return to its resting position. So if the spring has high stiffness, it would quickly snap back the object to resting position. And if the stiffness is low, it would slowly bring back the object to its resting position, like a loose suspension, and it will make the object bounce back and forth slowly. So this also has four constants: high, medium, low, and very low. And you can use them, or otherwise you can use any other positive value between this range. Now comes to resting position. So what is the resting position? Like when you start, when you are doing this when you are doing the spring animation, you want the spring force to apply and makes the animation rest at some position. So this is that resting position. Now you have understood all the properties of spring. Let's see how do we create this spring animation. So I'm using this spring animation constructor, where you can see I'm providing the which view I want to animate and the property we want to animate. Okay, and so the property we want to animate is translation X, since we want to bounce the view left and right. So after this, we also need to create a spring force, because the spring animation, because we are not providing a built-in spring force, and so that it will expect a custom spring force. We can create a spring force instance and set the value of the final resting position of the spring to zero, so that the view will come back to its starting point. Okay, and then we are setting the stiffness, we are setting the damping ratio, and then we are setting the spring force. Okay, and so now we have created our spring force, and we are just passing it to our spring animation. So now after the spring animation for translation X has been created, now we need to set up the touch listener. So after the touch listener, when you are releasing your finger up, you want the spring animation to be started on that object, and you want the spring to try to snap back the object to its resting position. So when you are in action up event, you start the spring animation as soon as you release your finger, so that object comes to its resting position. So now I have shown you how to do animation translate using spring animation. Now let's go through how to do the rotate and translate using spring animation. So as you can see in the GIF, as the list is flying in, each children of the spring animation shakes around as if they are hanging to a cloth lines that we are pulling in. So we have rotation on each children of the linear layout, and then we are providing a spring translate animation on the linear layout. So let's see how to achieve this. So to achieve this, I just told you, we need to apply a rotational spring force on each individual head, and along with a translation animation to slide this whole list in. Now, see, so again, we need to, because this is a force-based animation, so we have to create a spring force. We have to spring force with the initial rotation. I have set it at 0 degree. So, and with a high damping ratio and a low stiffness. So, and so what we are doing is we are creating this spring force because we want all the children to see a same spring force instance. So when that is done, we create this list animation, and we want to slide the list in, so we are creating a translation X property, and then we are setting the stiffness and damping ratio of 500 and 0.4f, and then we are setting the start value to -30, so that like each head rotate from a -30 degree angle and then oscillate around 0 degree and gradually comes to a stop. So in this follow-up, we are showing like we are creating a rotation animation instance for every children of the linear layout. So now for every children, a rotation animation will be created, and this will rotate from -30 degree to 0 degree. So now you are done, like, because you have provided the rotational force and translation force, and now your animation looks natural and beautiful. and it's easy to create, because if you are going to the way of object animator, you had so much code to write for this. Now let's go through fling animation. Now just like we bounce the view, now let's see how to fling a view which simulate like real world object being flung in a space. So when you fling an object in the real world, you give the object some initial velocity, like that's usually the velocity of your gesture from like your finger. And then it would continue to travel with some momentum before gradually coming to rest. And why does the object comes to rest? Because it has some force working on it, and that is the friction force, which slows down the velocity until the object stops. So now here you can see, like for simulating this fling behavior and graceful into the animation, we are using the fling animation class, and we are seeing like we are flinging the view from across x-axis and y-axis depending upon the fling gesture direction. So it's like some spring facts. Let's learn about some fling facts. So fling facts is like the force behind fling animation is a friction force. And the fling animation starts with initial velocity, and usually that's the velocity of your gesture. And fling animation continues with the momentum gained by the initial velocity, which it received from gesture, and then it gradually comes to a stop. And fling animation is proportional to velocity. What does that mean is, if the velocity is high, friction force that is being applied on the velocity to stop it also becomes high, making the object to come to rest very quickly. And when the velocity is low, friction force that is being applied on that velocity to stop it also becomes low, making the object to eventually slow down. So now you have seen what is the facts about fling animation. Now we have to provide three parameters to configure fling animation. Like the first one is start velocity, second one is minimum and maximum value, and the third is friction. Let's go one by one on this. So what is start velocity? Like you need to define a start velocity to ensure that the animation does not end right away, because by default the start velocity is configured to 0 pixels per second. If you don't do that, it would, like as soon as you fling the object, it would stop immediately. So you have to define it as I told you, because if you don't want the animation to end right away. And then we have minimum and maximum range. You need to define the property value within a certain range, and as soon as minimum or maximum value is reached, the fling animation gets stopped. And third is friction. This is a constant, like damping ratio constant in case of spring animation. So you need to define this constant to control the rate of slowing down of animation, like how much friction you want the want to apply on the object. So now, after these three parameters are set, in order to receive fling callbacks, when a fling gesture occurs, we need to set up a gesture listener. And once the fling gesture is detected, we receive the on fling callback with a down event, up event, and a velocity on both x and y axis. Like, and velocity units are in pixels per second. So now you're seeing I'm creating a fling animation constructor, and I'm providing the object I want to animate, and the property I want to animate is again translation x. So that the object I can fling in horizontally. And then again, because I told you we need to set three parameters for fling animation, so I'm setting some velocity, start velocity, and some minimum translation constant. Here I've defined minimum translation as 0, and maximum translation as, you know, the width of your phone or anything you can want to set on maximum translation. And then the friction constant. I've used friction as 1.1f, or you can use anything you want. You need to start the fling animation inside the onFling method. And again, you can see as the spring, your view has started and tuning with and dancing with your finger. So now, after spring and fling, these are the independent animations which we have learned. What we can create some complex animations, let's go and learn that. So now let's come to chained springs. So you're seeing three views. Like right now we have seen one views, now they are seeing three views which are chained together via some spring force. Like, you know, I'm dragged when I'm, you are seeing the, that white dot, that is the touch of my finger. So when I'm dragging the top view around, the other two views are following the top view. So such that like it feels like if that all the threes are attached with an elastic cord. So now let's look at how we can achieve this. So first, you need to understand that we have taken some reference like this. First is, let's suppose the first view is lead, and then is the first follower, and then there is a second follower. So for the first follower to follow the lead, when the lead is being dragged around, we need to set animations for the first follower. So I'm creating a spring animation for the first follower and providing the translation X property. Okay, and now once you can see, I'm also setting a touch listener, and in the touch event, I'm calculating the delta X values. The delta X values is like how much amount of movement has been done by your finger. So now you know how much movement has been done by your finger. Now you can update that value on the lead view, and when the lead view has been updated, you want the first follower to follow the lead. So what you do, I'm using a new function here, is animate to final position. What this method does, that if the animation has not yet started, this method would set the final position for the animation and start the animation. If this animation is already started and is already running, then this method would just update the final position for the animation. Like, remember in the past slides, I've shown you the target value change in the physics-based animation. So what we are doing is, like, if there is an already existing animation running, we just need to call this function and just need to provide the value. Okay, so what I'm doing is, I'm getting the translation X value from the lead. I'm then setting it up on the first follower, like for the same for the trans X and for the Y value, and just updating the last X and last Y for the motion events. Okay, and now, well, for the, how to do that for second follower. Same for the, like the first follower, we created spring animation on translation X and Y. We will create the same translation X and Y for the second follower. And when, and now you want to think about like how we are updating the, for the second follower. So we want the second follower to follow the first follower. So for that, we have an function called add update listener, which we are adding on the first follower. So such that whenever any animation update happens on the first follower, we get an callbacks, and there in that function, we can update the value for the second object. So now, right now, we are getting the animation value and velocity in this on animation update for the first follower. So just the trick is to set, call the animate to final position and set the animation value. Now this value which you are seeing is the same as the first follower value. So it's going to create a chained spring animation so that the lead value is updated to the first follower and the first follower values is updated to the second follower. And that's it. You have learned how to create a chain force. And so I'm concluding my slides with this new physics-based animation. We don't need to provide duration or start and end values for creating the physics-based animation. Because this animation is driven by force, as it mimics the law of physics. So you can create any cool animation with just a few lines of code. I'm just leaving this on you, and if it sounds cool, you can try it yourself to superpower your animations. The references and resources which I've used are these, if you want to try my demo app and tinker with the animations which I've used, you can go to this my GitHub profile and check out also my Medium article. Thank you. Any questions?
If anyone has any questions, there are two microphones there that you can use. Just stay in a row and use it if you want to. Okay?
Yes.
Okay. Yes. That's what I wanted to ask you. Great presentation, and thanks for the links.
Yeah. Thank you. Cool.
Then, if there are any questions left, thank you so much for your attention. You have a question. Okay.
Have you tried all these animations in any of your recent projects or something? And how do you feel about it? Like, is it good or are there any advantages, disadvantages?
Yes, the advantage is the less code complexity. Because for writing and simulating these kind of spring animations, you need to calculate so many things in the animator-based animation. And now in the Android animation APIs, it has come. So you can just create these complex animations in 3 to 4 lines of code. Thank you.
Are the calculations done by the CPU or the GPU?
Yes.
Are the graphics processing unit, did that do the calculations or was it the CPU?
I don't know about that.
Okay.
Thank you.